Welcome, everybody, to the first lecture we have this year sponsored by the Freedom Project at Wellesley College. Some of you know what that is, some of you are just about to learn more about what it is, having joined us as fellows this year, and some of you will find out more about it as this year proceeds. In consultation with the student fellows from last year, the Adam Smith Fellows, we discussed over the summer what kinds of things Wellesley students would like to hear that might be something they wouldn't ordinarily hear on the Wellesley campus. For many different reasons, which I won't go into, it's rather usually a better idea just to identify what it is that you think as a professor people aren't hearing and then find people to come and talk to students about that. So the reasons for that will become evident to many of you throughout the year, and some of you already know what the reasons are, but in our discussions over the summer, we decided that maybe what we would do is have a series, among the many things we would do, was have a series called Alternative Feminisms. And that's a kind of a provocative title, but the whole point of our project is to be provocative, at least from my point of view, in terms of the kind of person and professor I am. Provocation, being provocative, is actually a good thing. Being contentious is actually a good thing. Being contrary, being a contrarian, is actually a good thing. And sometimes giving offense is actually a good thing. I know that's hard for many of you to grasp, because all I hear from students these days is, you know, I was offended, or I don't want to offend somebody. And that kind of cultural climate is not very conducive to the life of the mind. So what we did is we sat down and we decided to think of people, intellectuals, public intellectuals, academics, and media figures who would come to Wellesley and give us perhaps a different view or a different vision of feminism than one is likely to encounter in an academic environment. Not just Wellesley, but in just about any academic environment. So I thought, who could fit that bill? Who is a critical intellectual who's not afraid to be contentious and provocative and to lead, to have her mind lead her to her own conclusions rather than the conclusions that fit into conventional wisdom and kind of reproduce the orthodoxies around her? And I thought immediately of Christina Hoff Summers, whose work I had followed for many, many years as somebody who is a student, a sociologist of ideology, and also a sociologist of knowledge. I became aware of her work, Who Stole Feminism, which was a very strident, polemical book about the current state of academic feminism, current at that time being in the 1990s. And I was attracted by the book because she pointed out that what was supposed to be liberating, what was supposed to be freeing, namely feminism, for her was a new kind of orthodoxy that actually held women back in terms of their advancement and their thinking. It was a very provocative book. And the mark of a good book, by the way, is how many people it will actually provoke to write bad reviews or negative reviews. And of course, you know, if you hit the mark in your thinking and you're a critical intellectual, you should expect a lot of blowback. And that's precisely what happened. But that was interesting in and of itself, because she had diagnosed what I thought was a very serious problem in academic feminism as a social theorist who had been trying to teach feminism in my classes and finding myself a little bit stymied by some of the types of thought I was running into. lo and behold, 10 years later or so, I'm not sure if it was 10 years, my colleague Jonathan Immer in the sociology department decided for fun and pleasure and intellectual excitement to teach a course on masculinities at Wellesley College. And it was notable for the fact that it filled up in the pre-registration period within about 90 seconds with 50 students. So clearly students wanted to know a lot about this. Then we said, well, what will we teach in that class? And started looking around for materials. And one of the books that we found was a book that also made a big splash called The War Against Boys, which is also a book by Professor Summers, which is a very powerful critique of the, or a powerful elaboration analysis, very deeply seated sociological analysis of how boys, the real crisis in education today, the real crisis in our culture, is not what it once was how girls would advance and how girls could advance, but actually the situation of boys. And it occurred to me at the time that in raising my own daughters that I had, in fact, could see how my daughters had been facilitated by many of the progressive movements to bring women and girls into education, but that boys were being somehow left behind. So if you had told me, for instance, 25 years ago when I arrived at Wellesley, and well, it seems like forever now, but that if you had told me that 52% of the population in college would be girls and 48% would be boys, I would have told you you were crazy. It's just impossible to happen that fast. But it has happened that fast. So what is the story about boys? And that book, again, being provocative and being powerful, which received a lot of blowback from critics, claiming that it was ignoring some of the real data about the fate of girls. But I think that what's great, what I love about Professor Hoff's work is that she's not afraid to go into, which I think is the root of the sociological imagination, even though she's not a sociologist, although I think of her as one. I'm not sure I told you that. She's a philosopher, but she's not afraid to challenge conventional wisdoms, not afraid to debunk and to challenge orthodoxies, which I think is, if you take, as I do, say, John Stuart Mill's book on liberty, he makes this plea, says you must challenge orthodoxies. You must challenge your own thinking, and you must challenge other people's thinking. I think she embodies this in a way that really crystallizes the spirit of the Freedom Project as I've laid it out. So Professor Summers was for many years a professor at Clark University right down the road in Worcester, and actually lived in this area, and now is a fellow at the American Enterprise Institute, which I should point out is not a common ground for us to recruit speakers from at Wellesley College. So I'm very delighted to be able to welcome her to come to Wellesley. She's come up special for the day to talk to us about the topic freedom and feminism. Thank you very much for having me.
Well, I made myself. I intend to speak for no more than 30, 35 minutes and then open it up for discussion because that's always the most exciting part. This afternoon, I am going to defend a style of feminism that I call freedom feminism. When I wrote the book, Who Stole Feminism? It was freedom feminism that was stolen. I want it back. And it stands for, freedom feminism stands for the moral, social, and legal equality of the sexes and the freedom of women to employ that their equal status and to pursue happiness in their own distinctive way. Freedom feminism is not at war with femininity and masculinity. It does not view men and women as opposing tribes. Theories about universal patriarchal oppression are not part of its founding documents. There are no partisan litmus tests. It welcomes women and men from across the political spectrum. And put simply, freedom feminism affirms for women what it affirms for everyone. Dignity, fairness, personal liberty. Before I get into a discussion of freedom feminism, I just want to say a few words about my background. Way back in the 1990s, I was a philosophy professor in good standing with my feminist colleagues. My articles were cross-listed in, some were published in feminist anthologies, and I was invited to referee papers for women's journals. My courses were cross-listed with women's studies. That all changed in around 1994 when I published this book, Who Stole Feminism? Now that book, I thought, was strongly feminist, but I rejected the idea that American women were oppressed. I said that American women, thanks to the women's movement and many other changes in American culture, we were arguably the freest women in the world, and certainly in history. It was no longer reasonable to say that women as a group were worse off than men. Yes, women still had problems, but so did men. It just was a complicated mix of benefits and burdens. And I did not deny in the book that there were still inequities. However, to refer to American society as patriarchal or some kind of a male hegemony seemed to me to be absurd. So in the book, I tried to show how feminism had been hijacked by gender war eccentrics, largely in the universities. And when I say eccentric, I do mean eccentric. One of my colleagues in feminist philosophy, she wasn't at Clark, she was at Washington University. I was looking at some feminist textbooks or anthologies, and she had written one, and she dedicated it to the students in my women's studies ovular in the spring of 91. And I hadn't seen the word ovular before, and I always like to look up a new word, but before I could get to the dictionary, I realized I wasn't going to find it because the professor had made it up. She didn't like the word seminar, with its root word connected to the very essence of masculinity. So she changed it to what she thought, well, don't even think about it. Now, it was funny, but as I read her book, I realized she wasn't kidding. This was a kind of a serious effort at liberating language from its masculinist roots. Now, when my book was first published, I did get some fan mail from prominent feminists who actually agreed with me. Nadine Strossen, president of the ACLU, just said, you know, go, this is great. And Erica Jong, the author of Fear of Flying, she wrote me a fan letter. But fortunately, the fan letters did not last. Many of my colleagues, particularly in feminist philosophy and in feminist theory, did not appreciate my plea for moderation, and I was called a backlasher, a traitor to my gender, anti-woman. On one occasion, an angry critic even called me, actually, this is what she said, Christina Hoff Sommers and Margaret Thatcher, those two female impersonators. Well, actually, I have a picture that was taken once at an event with Margaret Thatcher. So it's the two of us together. And sometimes I show it, but we do look a little like female impersonators in that picture, but never mind. Anyway, I hope that I'm not a backlasher, a traitor, anti-woman, and I'm certainly not a female impersonator. What I am is a former philosophy professor with a tremendous respect for logic, clear thinking, rules of evidence, and I hope a strong sense of fairness. So I think that it is my bias towards logic, reason, and fairness that put me at odds with some in the feminist establishment. Now I realize that is a harsh thing to say, but I'm going to try to back it up. And I will also tell you that as a philosopher, I try to be open-minded, and I work mightily against a very dangerous habit of mind. And you've probably heard about confirmation bias. Whatever you believe, there's this natural tendency to be very, very open to confirming evidence and very resistant to anything that could unsettle the beliefs you hold to be true. And as a trained philosopher, I fight that so much in myself, and I make a strong commitment to you tonight, to this afternoon, wherever we're this evening, that I'm not here to assert a set of dogmatic views. I'd love to have my views challenged. If I find out I'm wrong, I change. And I am less contentious. I was a little too strident in Who Stole Feminism, and I just found that wasn't a good way to communicate. So over the years, I've tried to be, I've tried desperately to understand what the other person is saying, where they're coming from, and have respect for it, and to have a civil exchange. So maybe you were promised a sort of firebrand, but I'm going to be polite and I hope reasonable. When asked, are you a feminist? Most Americans say no. I'll just give a recent poll that this has been done over and over again. It was the Huffington Post YouGov poll. 23% of women and 16% of men identified as feminist. And they've had stories in the news that these very accomplished women, from Taylor Swift to Sandra Day O'Connor, Gwyneth Paltrow, Marissa Mayer, Beyonce, they object to the designation. Now, how can this be? I mean, if you think about it, the emancipation of women under the banner of feminism. That is one of the glories of Western civilization. It's one of the great chapters in the history of freedom. So why has that banner lost its allure? Why do so few women identify? And men, as for men, most of them, they run for cover when you bring it up. Terry O'Neill, president of the National Organization for Women, she had an answer. Someone asked her, why so many women, you would think that poor women, would resonate to feminism, or If you look, women of color are hardly there in terms of the representation of the National Organization for Women and the big organizations in D.C. They don't have a large constituency outside kind of a small coterie of rather elite white women. The movement has not engaged the imagination of the mainstream and women that it thinks that it can help have not resonated to the cause. But Terry O'Neill, president of NOW, said it was the media's fault that the media unfairly portrayed feminists as being, quote, unhappy, angry, and humorless. Now my question is, I think these stereotypes are unfounded and unfair. However, I do think there's a serious problem with a kind of image of feminism in society. Think of someone like Jessica Valenti. She's a popular blogger. And here's a quote from her. She wrote this in the Washington Post a couple of years ago about women's oppression. We have no problem condemning atrocities done to women abroad, yet too many of us in the United States ignore the oppression in our doorsteps. We're suffering under the mass delusion that American women have achieved equality. Part of this unwillingness to see misogyny in America could be self-protection. Perhaps the truth is just too scary to face. Now, I would say that women of all persuasions want their basic rights. But most women do not think of themselves as being enthralled to a mass delusion or held down by some system of global oppression. I mean, but to identify as a feminist today in the mainstream society, to call yourself a feminist, is to claim association with a kind of dire worldview. So most women, and as I said, lots of men, simply keep their distance. Now, what I think is that, and some people have said this to me, well, if the movement is so marginal and you're getting just a fairly small percentage of people identifying with it, why not just let it go? Let it fall by the weight of its own insignificance. Well, I think that, I do believe the major battles for equality and opportunity have been fought and largely won. And I believe in many quarters women are actually have not simply achieved equality, we are dominating, certainly in education. However, I do think the work of feminism is unfinished. Across the globe, there are fledgling women's groups struggling to survive in face of genuine and often violent oppression. And I've been to several conferences, international women's rights conferences, and these women come and speak to our groups and tell about what's going on in their country. It could be Cambodia, it could be in Iran, which was a kind of 1984 for women right now. There are women coming from Egypt where they widespread practice of genital mutilation, and they're trying to fight it in their country. Fantastic women leaders fighting for women's rights in their various countries in Africa. These inspiring women, and I feel like I'm seeing, you know, the Elizabeth Cady Stanton and the Susan B. Anthony, but from other countries. They are the freedom fighters, and they come and ask, they want us to make common cause with them or help them in some way. And I always wonder why the women's movement in the United States isn't there isn't this more outreach. There is some of the women's groups are certainly doing a great deal of work with women's rights. But if you compare the campus today to what it was, say, in the 80s, when we wanted to dismantle apartheid in South Africa, that was a huge movement. Where is anybody wanting to do that for the women struggling in Iran or the women struggling in Egypt, the women's groups? I'm not saying we go in and impose American feminism on them. I'm saying we help them with their liberation causes. So anyway, it's these women that have taught me that we certainly still need a healthy and vibrant feminism because we, American women, we did, and women throughout the West, but especially in the United States, we had a successful movement of emancipation. And women throughout the world are organizing and aspire to this. And so that's one reason why we cannot let feminism disappear. I think also that in the West, I think our popular culture contains many strong elements of misogyny. It's not terribly nice to men, it's misandrist as well. But women are, I think, especially vulnerable to this just the court, the completely disrespectful and often even just images of violence and so forth in the media, and of denigration. And finally, women struggle more than men in combining work and family. The previous generations of feminists managed to liberate their sisters, but we did not solve the problem of work and family. So despite immense progress, the poverty is largely, if you look at the poverty rolls, it's largely women and children. It's called the feminization of poverty. So what I am calling for, though I'm not an organizer, so nothing will come of it unless people find it interesting, I'm calling for a kind of rehabilitation of feminism, and try to refashion the movement in a way that would actually resonate with women. Change the movement so that American women, women of color, Hispanic women, working class women would find it attractive and interesting, because if you look at the data right now, there is just very little connection between the organized women's movement and large groups of women in America. Now, to do that, I'm going to give you a little history lesson of how it did work in the past and how we might do it again. In order to do that, though, to change feminism, I think it's going to have to be reality-based. And by that, I'm going to explain, you're going to have to get rid of the propaganda and the phony statistics about how oppressed we are. It's a sensitive issue, but I am afraid that in all of my years studying feminism, that at the heart of campus feminism, anyway, is a body of egregiously false information, data depicting women as victims in a very reckless, irresponsible way. And I'll be quite specific about that in a minute. We need a reality-based, I think we also need to be male-respecting. I think that for feminism to make it into the new millennium and to become a successful world movement, it must not denigrate men. And there is a lot of male bashing. I became a feminist in the 70s because I did not appreciate male chauvinism. I still do not. But I see a lot of bigotry and chauvinism now coming in the other direction. And I dislike it just as much. So we need a judicious feminism. I believe that if we had those things, if we had a feminism that was based, that was reality-based, based in good data, good research, good information, honest information, that was male-respecting and judicious, I think we could greatly help women, both in the United States and around the world. And that's what I call, that's what I'm calling freedom feminism. Now, if you pick up a typical women's studies textbook, I'm not talking about all of them, but or you visit a typical women's college center, and I'm sure Wellesley is the exception, you're likely to encounter a certain amount of, I would say almost conspiracy theories about the patriarchy, about male hegemony. Students are taught that they inhabit an oppressive society where women are conditioned to subordination and cheated out of their salaries, self-esteem diminished, their health neglected, and all these injustices. And as I said, a lot of these statistics, if you look at them carefully, I won't go into it now, but in Who Stole Feminism, I unpack one after the other. And as I said, to show that this was so disheartening to me as a philosopher, to see that there's propaganda. There's propaganda in our textbooks at the highest levels. People don't check their facts, and these things can't be corrected. I got a big argument with a professor, Nancy Lemon at Berkeley, who wrote a book on domestic violence, and she was repeating what were just ludicrous urban legends. It was in the Chronicle of Higher Education. I wrote it, and then she answered, and then I wrote a letter back, and a lot of people replied. But at that, if you're interested in misinformation, you can just look at Google Nancy Lemon, Christina Summers, and there we are. So we have these shocking claims about women's oppression, that buttress this view that women are victims in our society. And the problem is this style of feminism has tenure. It has a monopoly on the discourse women in our universities, and feminism has devolved into a one-party system. And others aren't welcome. you're just not welcome at the table. And it's such an irony, because I remember the early sort of heady days of feminism, and finally we had a place at the table. Men had presided over fields like psychology and sociology and philosophy, and now women had a voice. Except that women don't really have a voice. The official centers of scholarship, like in women's studies, are often occupied by women who speak. I mean, yeah, they have doctrinal feuds, you know, the Marxists don't like the Freudians and the eco-feminists, but it's the gamut from A to B. The left, most of women have been left out. We do not have a voice. You are not welcome at the table in most universities unless you are part of the sisterhood and can sort of pass a series of tests about on your opinions. And I think that has left, I mean, I just think women have been left out. And it's a small, a very, very small clique, but it has power, because in Washington, D.C., there's this women's lobby, and you have groups like the American Association of University Women, the National Organization for Women, the National Women's Law Center. Now, these groups started in the 70s, or at least even before, in the 60s, and we needed them, and they grew up. All around the country, you've got these great groups fighting for women's basic rights, which had been denied. And many of them were enormously successful. I mean, imagine you're the American Association of University Women. It started in the 19th century. And your purpose is to let women be educated on a par with men. And you fight for that. Well, what do you do when it's, you know, 2013 and women are not 52%? Now it's changed since my book. It's 57% of college enrollments are women. And Department of Education projections see this trajectory. It almost went like this. It used to be more men, and then they started going like that in terms of proportion, and women went like that. Well, it's actually like that. No. Anyway, the men in education are falling way behind. But you've got an American Association of University Women, very committed to their cause. Do you think they just give up and shut their doors and say, okay? They don't. It's almost as if they become more invested in an ideology of women as a victim, even in education, which is extraordinary. So this lobby, mostly in Washington, but and also in New York, it continues to be the case that at our universities, it tends to be dominated by the cultural left, and other women are not invited to the party. I say a flourishing and healthy women's movement needs to have both a conservative and a liberal wing. And I'm going to try to prove that in a moment. Today, all we have is a kind of eccentric, radical wing. Now, to understand what went wrong and why I think conservatives can set it right, I want to briefly consult the historical record. And we'll just more very briefly go back to the 18th and 19th century. In the 18th century, 19th century, what you find are very two distinct schools of thought and activism around women. There were two schools that historians have identified, and I agree with this. There was always an egalitarian feminism. This was the more progressive, and the egalitarians, some would call them radical. They were considered radical in their time. They viewed women as independent agents rather than wives and mothers. They very much wanted to liberate women from the social role. In particular, they wanted to liberate women from the private sphere. And because women were in the home and men were everywhere else, and they wanted women in the public sphere. These were very much feminists that were inspired by the Enlightenment. According to the Enlightenment, men and in their essential nature. Let me put it this way: they sought to liberate women through appeals to Enlightenment principles, social justice, and universal rights. So that's Enlightenment feminism or egalitarian feminism, and you probably know a lot about that. But there was a second school, which is kind of a lost continent. And I've had a great deal of fun going back and reading a group, scholars give them various names. Some call them social feminists, some call them maternal feminists. Now, what were they? Well, they were traditionalists. They were largely religious, family-centered women who embraced rather than rejected women's established role as homemaker, caretaker, provider of domestic tranquility. They loved their private sphere, but they promoted women's rights by redefining, strengthening, and expanding those roles. Now, of the two, now here's what's interesting. Of the two schools, maternal feminism was by far more popular and politically influential, because unlike its radical sister, it had enormous appeal to large majorities of women. Now you'll say, well, how was it subversive? Well, I will explain. The egalitarian that you've probably heard of, the Enlightenment feminist, was Mary Wollstonecraft, 1759 to 1797. Wollstonecraft was a rebel and a free thinker. She led one of the most exciting lives of the 18th century. That's saying a lot. She believed that women were as intelligent as men and worthy of respect. She had the audacity to say that. And her seminal work, The Vindication of the Rights of Women, was an instant sensation. And as I said, she wrote in the spirit of the European Enlightenment, and its primary principle was the essential dignity, moral equality of rational human beings. And Wollstonecraft insisted that women, too, were rational. But for her, education, women's education, that was the key to liberation. She said, quote, strengthen the female mind by enlarging it, and there will be an end to blind obedience. And this institution, I mean, this is the realization of the dreams of Mary Wollstonecraft. Now, if Wollstonecraft was, so at the time Wollstonecraft was writing, there was another woman, far more famous in her time, Hannah Moore, M-O-R-E, 1745 to 1833. Hannah Moore was a novelist, a poet, a political activist, an evangelical reformer, an abolitionist. She was waging a very different kind of campaign for women's freedom. If Wollstonecraft was the founder of egalitarian feminism, Moore is the founder of maternal feminism. Now, they had a lot in common. Wollstonecraft was the consort of the greatest men of her age, so was Hannah Moore. Hannah Moore, like Mary, was a self-made woman who became the intellectual peer of the most accomplished men of her day. As one biographer says of Hannah Moore, in her time, she was better known than Mary Wollstonecraft. Her books outsold Jane Austen's many times over. There are some historians who credit Hannah Moore for preventing England from having the equivalent of the French Revolution, because she wrote these pamphlets and challenged Tom Paine and other she considered to be radicals. And she was with a group of people that have always fascinated me. They were evangelical Christians prominent in England from 1790 to about 1830, called the Clapham sect. And today we think evangelicals, and we think that means conservative. Well, this was where abolitionism was born. Every great humanitarian movement, see, they were kind of aristocrats, became very religious, and they were part of this sect, and out of this movement was born these humanitarian movements. Prison reform, prevention of cruelty to animals, children. William Wilberforce, you may have heard of him, a father of the British abolition movement. Hannah Moore was there, and for her, she wanted to improve the lives of women. Now, historians have called Hannah Moore a bourgeois progressivist, a Christian capitalist, she liked the free market, and the first Victorian. But as I said, I call her the first maternal feminist. Now, unlike Mary Wollstonecraft, she thought the sexes were different in their propensities, attitudes, and preferences. But she believed in an empowered femininity. According to Moore, women are the natural caretakers of the nation. And she would write this in these pamphlets. She was sort of both an intellectual and kind of a Ann Landers of her time, or a vice columnist. And she would tell women, especially aristocratic women who were involved in sort of frivolous activities and embroidery and little tea parties, she would say, no, you are domestic heroines and you must go out. And she wanted armies of intelligent, informed, educated women working in hospitals, orphanages, schools, and she appealed to women that it was their patriotic duty to be both firm and feminine for the greater good of all. Here's the extraordinary thing about her, is that women listened. She changed British society in ways which historians still find extraordinary. She was probably the most famous woman, probably the most famous woman of her day, and known here in the United States as well. But and here's the thing: she strongly believed in women's education, and so she shared that. Now just think what happens. I'm not saying that all. You can go back and read her, and some of the things she says sound reactionary. Other things sound visionary. But what happens to women once they become, they're out working in hospitals, and they're in orphanages, and they're no longer at home, then historians have shown that's when women begin, they're out in the public sphere. And then they begin, after that, the suffrage movement developed out of these early groups of women who were, and these were both aristocratic middle class, and she preached to poor women. She wanted self-improvement for all. Everyone had to read. That's why she launched Sunday schools. She didn't launch them, but she developed a network of schools for girls and boys too, but especially to educate girls. So she changed the way the society saw itself, and she changed women's roles. But she did it in terms that women could understand. And there are some fantastic 18th century historians at UCLA whom I love, who study very carefully, and they think that she was maybe one of the most subversive feminists of her age because she changed things so much for women, but without ruffling feathers. There was a way to kind of ride trends, conservative trends, but then turn them towards progress. And she was a genius at that. But we've got another example. Let's go on to the 19th century. And again, what we find, took so much time with this part. All right, I'm going to move on. Frances Willard, one of the most beloved and respected women of the 19th century, and she marries Elizabeth Cady Stanton and Susan B. Anthony. They were egalitarian feminists. I love them. I admire them. But if you read about the suffrage movement, years and years, they brought the Enlightenment to women, and women were either indifferent or hostile. It was not a successful movement. They were desperate. They needed new ideas. And Frances Willard came along. She was born in 1839, died in 1898. She was one of the most beloved and respected women in 19th century America. And she was the president of the Christian Temperance Union. Now we think of temperance and we think of, I don't know, Carrie Nation, you know, with her axe, and this axe-wielding woman in saloons. But under Frances Willard, it became a humanitarian movement to improve schools, and again, sort of like the Clapham sect of prison reform. And she took to conservative women, traditional women, the idea that they should vote. And she even rebranded suffrage. She called it the Home Protection Ballot. And she began to bring the suffrage movement, something they had not had before, electoral victories. Because there were municipalities that would vote, should women have the vote? And then the states began to have votes, and after Willard's minions would go there with their conservative message that and this is the thing, she knew that women wanted to protect the home, the private sphere, and so she would say, it's the home protection ballot, and the saloon was the enemy of the home, because men would get drunk, and then they'd spend the family wage, or they'd come home and attack their wives and children. There is a historian at Brandeis University, Janet Zollinger Gila, and she tells how Americans won the suffrage when these two paths came together. This is her thesis. She said we had the egalitarian path of Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and then we had Frances Willard, this sort of, you know, with religious family, you know, mothers and wives. And here's her quote. History records defeat in every instance where one branch failed to recognize the valid arguments of the other. When the two branches cooperated, success followed. And she thinks that history will be best when we have two movements, a progressive and a conservative wing, working together. And that's why I believe today that we need a revision, we need a rehabilitation, we need to rediscover this, the lost conservative tradition. Now, of course, we are 21st century people, we're not going to go back to the 18th and 19th century. So what I've tried to do was take what I thought was best from egalitarianism and from maternal feminism and combine it, and that's really what freedom feminism is. I share with the egalitarians, I share with Susan B. Anthony and Mary Wollstonecraft the idea that women, no woman should be forced to conform to a sex stereotype or a gender role appropriate to her sex. No one should be forced to do that. I am totally in favor of liberation from gender roles. On the other hand, I will say most women, even free and self-determining educated women, even under those conditions, they do not choose to be just like men. So here's what I'm proposing, is that what we need is a feminist movement that accepts that there's an exit clause. You do not have to inhabit the traditional role. But if you prefer to inhabit that role, we should respect it. It should not be viewed, if a woman, for example, wants to be a traditional writing mother, if she wants to abandon her career and so forth, that is something that must be respected. And there are going to be consequences that beyond, because some of you will think, well, so who cares, nobody's stopping her. You'll see what I mean when we look at what the women's groups are doing right now. Now, most of today's activists, not on campus, because feminist theory on campus has gone off into all sorts of directions, but in when I talked before about the women's lobby in Washington, they are still trying very hard to create an androgynous, gender-integrated society where the sex roles disappear. Now, I think that Hannah Moore and Frances Willard were right to say that there are differences between the sexes. I think what they forgot is that even though there are differences, there are many exceptions. As many as 20% of men or women will be totally defied the stereotypes. But about 80% of us embody them, and I want more respect for those who embody, and I want respect for those who defect from those roles and those stereotypes. In 2013, there was a poll by the Pew Research Center this year. They asked mothers and fathers, what is your ideal? What was your ideal living arrangement? 61% of mothers said they would prefer to work part-time or not at all. Fathers said 75% said they wanted to work full-time. Catherine Hakim is an economist in Britain. And she's years and years she studied women in the Western democracies. How do they live? What do they want? 20% of women in the Western democracy want to be full-time wives and mothers. They don't want to work at all. 20% are high-powered careerists, as ambitious as any man you've ever met. 60% are adaptives, she calls them. They kind of want to do both. They want to work part-time or have children and go. That's where the 60% are. So it seems to me that according to many in the feminist lobby, the female tendency to give priority to domesticity or women that want to stay home, or if you look at what women major in college, it's very different from what guys major in. After all these years of consciousness raising, you can make a lot of money. You want to close the wage gap? You're a Wellesley feminist, you want to close it? You should major in petroleum engineering, because the pay for that is sky high. Mining engineering is good. You could also do a third very high paying field is metallurgy. You might want to think about that. Do they have a metallurgy major? I don't know. They're encouraging the wage gap. The fact is that those fields are largely occupied by men. Women, Christian majors, are some of the lowest paying fields. Sociology is one, but certainly early childhood education, it's almost all female, and as well as most of the social sciences and humanities, females dominate those fields by large numbers. Now, you could say, well, diehard feminists will say, well, that's still social conditioning. And at a certain point, I asked myself, at what point Well, they give that up. They almost have a theory that can't be falsified. Because anytime you show them evidence to the contrary, they just take it right in as evidence of proof, even how more deeply entrenched the patriarchy is, because women are still making these false choices. And I just want to throw out a couple of ideas, and then I'm going to open it up for discussion. In 2008, the Journal of Personality and Social Psychology published, actually, I'm not going to tell you that study, but I'm going to tell you my theory. This was in 2009. The American Psychological Association did a study called Men and Things, Women and People. Oh, no, no, that one. I'm sorry. Okay. Going back to the 2008. Here's what I find fascinating. They looked at personality, gender and personality across 55 nations. And in every country they studied, the women tended to be more cooperative, nurturing, risk-averse, and emotionally expressive. The men were more competitive, reckless, and emotionally flat. Well, that sounds sort of negative. I'll say stoical. Well, here's what I find most fascinating about this study of 55 nations. Personality differences between men and women were the largest, most robust in prosperous, egalitarian, post-industrial societies like ours. According to the authors, the higher level of health, education, you know, human development, access to knowledge, the greater the variation between men and women. A New York Times writer summarized the study this way. It looks as if personality differences between men and women are smaller in traditional cultures in you know, rural India or Zimbabwe than in the Netherlands or the United States. A husband and a stay-at-home wife in patriarchal Botswana seem to be more alike than a working couple in Denmark or France. So the more Venus and Mars have equal rights and similar jobs, the more their personalities diverge. Now, how could this be? How could men and women in the United States in 2013 be more different than in a, you know, men and women would be in a rural society in Botswana? Well, here's what the authors suggest. They say in prosperous egalitarian nations, there are more opportunities for self-actualization. So wealth, freedom, and education empower men and women to be who they want to be who they are. So I think just as we have seen gay liberation is more likely to emerge in advanced post-industrial societies, it looks to me as though such societies afford heterosexuals more opportunities to embrace their gender identities. So you will, the research, I mean, this is far from conclusive, but it's intriguing, and I think it has a lot of explanatory power. I mean, just think of it. What if gender difference turns out to be a phenomenon not of oppression, but of social well-being, of liberation? I'll just give you a concrete example. People say, oh, in Malaysia and in Honduras, you know, they have more women and engineers than they do in the United States. That proves that we're sexist. Maybe not. Maybe it proves that we're wealthy and afford opportunities, and women can do what they want. And they don't want to do, if they don't, they're not choosing engineering, they're choosing artistry or anthropology or communications or whatever it is. Anyway, after 40 years of consciousness raising and gender neutral programs, there's very little likelihood that we're going to get equal outcomes. And I'll just end with this. You take something like, what would the world look like if we were all freedom feminists? How would it change? Well, first of all, if you looked at something like the gender wage gap or the gap in political leadership, it's not necessarily discrimination. It could be that men and women, left to them, their own, you know, according to their own lights, are choosing different paths. And so women may put greater priority on some fulfillment than being a metallurgist and earning more money. Freedom feminism allows that there can be innocent explanations for disparities. I'm enough of an equity feminist or egalitarian to say that. No, there might not be, we have to look into it, but at least allow for the possibility that when people say, oh, women only earn 77 cents for the dollar, that's not necessarily a statistic that shows you that unfairness and discrimination. In fact, economists can't really find out where the discrimination is once they do all the controls, but we'll get into that. So what I say is we should focus on genuine injustice, not just statistical disparities. Second, I think we have to I think if we had a women's movement that had conservatives and liberals, we could find imaginative solutions to horrible problems in this society. I think conservative and liberal women working together maybe could do something about the misogyny in the popular culture. And if you take something like the feminization of poverty, the Freedom Feminists could join with their progressive sisters in working for, I mean, I am sympathetic. I think we have to have initiatives to assist poverty-stricken single mothers. That's the feminization of poverty. But on the other hand, we have to look at the source of the feminization of poverty, which is fatherlessness, which is a culture of family disintegration. And it's dysfunctional. It just can't go on. If you look at the data and you see what's happening in our society and the impact it has on young men coming from the raising, it's a significant problem, and it's one that liberals and conservatives could work on together. And finally, and that's my last point, the geographic focus of the women's movement in the United States and of freedom feminism would shift to the developing world, where we would find their modern-day Susan B. Anthony's and Elizabeth Cady Stanton's and Frances Willard's. There are a lot of Frances Willard's. A lot of in the Muslim world, I find them. I find women that are traditionally religious. They do not want to. They love being mothers, but they want their rights. But they're not rebelling against their gender role. And I think history suggests that if there was a coalition of conservative and progressive women, we could be a powerful source for change. So my advice to you today is to take back feminism, reform it, correct its excesses, make it male-friendly, insist that moderate and conservative women be given a voice, and most of all, make common cause with women across the globe who are struggling for their basic freedoms. The Aviolar is now over. I will take questions. Thank you.
Thank you for coming to speak. So I am a women's and gender studies major here, and I really enjoy the major, but I understand that I should always come at, you know, even need to question my textbook, for example. So what advice for what would you tell me?
To find another point of view?
Or, I mean, unless you think I shouldn't be a gender studies major at all.
Oh. You know, when gender studies, all of these fields are exciting, but no field can survive if there are ideological limits on what can be thought and said. To me, there's one, I think gender scholars, like who are the geniuses, who are the great, great minds, who are going to last and be read? For me, there's only one, and that's Camille Paglia. And you might not even have heard her, because she's persona non grata in many gender studies, but maybe not yours. But she's just this completely dazzling, original woman. And she's gay. She's a lesbian. She calls herself, Catholic, pagan, libertarian, a lesbian who loves men. She loves male culture and so, but she does not like what's happened to feminism because she thinks that it's too, in gender studies, she thinks that it's too constricting. And she says it could have just opened itself up and allowed everybody in and just had magnificent exchanges and certainly bring in the biologists and the, psychologists who study gender differences and can tell you that it's not just a cultural creation, it's not just a social construction. We see even in, you know, vervet monkeys, little baby vervet monkey females and males, they play with different toys. The male goes towards the gadgets and the female towards the dollies or little baby-like toy. Why would that be? Was that socially constructed by culture? Maybe they have a vervet monkey culture that's sexist. I don't know, but I'm just saying I want more of that to be in gender studies. And I know there are some good departments where it is, but overall, a lot of it has been dominated by French philosophy. It's not taken that seriously by American philosophers. It's sort of warmed over Marxism or Freudianism or some odd combination thereof. So it's not clear-headed. So I worry about at the level of theory. I worry about the data, a lot of the false statistics. And then I worry about the lack of intellectual diversity. Yes?
Thank you for coming here, too. I'm not sure if I understood your whole like perspective or point, because I don't really see what's the difference that you're trying to kind of like promote for. I feel like you're kind of more criticizing white Western feminism than feminism in general. Feminism in our days like has many different like interests and goals and interpretation like this. And Muslim feminism is African American feminism, there is also feminism. And it is like what you say, that it's more about promoting deconstructing social kind of ideas of gender and gender roles, and also kind of having women making their own choices, whether to be a full-time mom or a full-time CEO or whatever. I think that is what feminism is in our day, and I'm not sure how your feminism is kind of criticizing that or kind of like adding a new idea to it.
Well, I will only tell you that you may hear, I'll give you an example, every week we hear from major women's groups this deplorable fact that women still earn only 77 cents for every dollar a man earns. And this is proof that we are still far from achieving equality. Now, as a freedom feminist who cares about data and good evidence, I want to know what explains that difference. Is it that you get the idea from the women's groups, and we have a big holiday, sort of, and this, it's not big, but you hear about it all over Washington, Pay Equity Day, and it's like how, I don't know, it's in April, it's how many more months a woman has to work just to catch up with what her male counterpart earns. And but all of this doesn't make sense to me, because when economists, including good feminist economists, look at the earnings of men and women, and they do a few controls, and they say, okay, what did this person study in college? What field did they go into? How many hours did they work a week? How many years did they take out? And you do that for everybody. What happens to the wage gap? It begins to narrow to the point of vanishing. There was a brilliant study done by, commissioned by the U.S. Labor Department, and they were able to get it down to something between 5 and 7 cents they couldn't account for. But they said you can't say that's because of discrimination. It could be something that it's escaping our measurements. Something different between the sexes that no one's to, for which no one's to blame. So I just wonder, why do we have a women's movement that holds on to this fake statistic, which a lot of them know. I don't think people deliberately. Now, oh, here's why I think they do it. I think that they know it's not really that employers are discriminating. I think they think, well, in a fair society, men and women would earn the same. But that means in a fair society, men and women would be the same. And I don't think they're the same. Because I think that the more liberated we are and the freer we are, we're going to be more and more different. You're going to find people as long as we remain prosperous. If we get poor, we'll all have to work very hard at things we don't want to do. But if you have the prosperity and the opportunity to do what you want to do, women do not. Women want a lot of things, but we don't appear to want to be men. We just don't. So if you agree with me, then you might despair over laws that are being promoted in Washington, all the Pay Equity Act. You know, they're really going to punish employers for what? The employers are not, we can't find, I mean, that, I don't say there aren't employers who are discriminating, the pockets of discrimination, but overall, no one can find it, and because it's not there. It's women being women, and women are more distracted by children than men are. And so, how do you overcome that, and why call it an injustice if it's just who we are? Or take something like, or anything, even if you look at, people say, well, look at the CEOs of Fortune 500s, and they're, I don't know, it changes every year, only 18 women. Again, I think the pool of women, remember that data that I gave you, there are about 20% of women who are high-powered careers. You have a much smaller pool of women who aspire for that. So how are you, you know, And women are much more, as I said, distracted by children. So when it comes time to pick this, you will find them. You're going to find your Marissa Mayers. And I think they're more and more coming along. But to expect parity would be expect to women to all along to have studied the same kinds of things as men. Like a lot of CEOs were engineers. A disproportionate number were engineers. Working 60, 70 hours a week year after year, you just find far more men that are interested in doing that, that do that, and women take other paths. And I find that a measure of freedom and well-being, not oppression. Yes?
Thank you for coming. As well, I have a lot of thoughts right now, so I'm going to try to vocalize it really coherently. But if I'm correct, the argument that you had was that feminism should be inclusive of women, what they want, what their desires are, and not inclusive to any political party or any group of women or designation that women might fall under. Is that correct?
Well, I guess that's right. But I also thought there are huge social problems. And we've got two examples from the 18th century and the 19th century where people weren't getting anywhere with these problems, but then when women came together, they solved them. They made huge progress with getting women into the public sphere in the 18th century, into education, and then it happened again in the suffrage. So.
I think that's a really valid point, and I think that it's really important for women to be open to other women's desires and not for them to fit a specific, identity, I suppose. But one question I did have is that if you look at the notion of collective versus individual rights, individuals may have certain opinions or desires that are contrary to what a collective might feel. And so my question is, if we are trying to be more inclusive of a broader collective of women, wouldn't we inherently kind of be losing the centrality of the message of feminism if we're only kind of including women for the sake of the notion of feminism? So I guess, for example...
Oh, yeah, I see what you mean. Yeah, but for me, it was more, I don't want to just have it for the sake of feminism. I think why I identified specific problems. We have the misogyny in the culture. We have the disintegration of the family, which is taking a horrible toll on women and children, and men, by the way, on everybody. It's not going to work. It's dysfunctional. There's no government program in the world that's going to be able to handle that. You're just going to have misery and poverty. So you've got to try to... I think that's something. So it's really women solving problems, but these are problems that are of special interest, I think, to feminists.
Right.
Of poverty and misogyny.
Yeah, I understand that. I guess my general question is that how do you maintain a central message of feminism when you try to expand it to a broader collective of women who have varying political opinions, varying agendas, varying desires, so why do we need the designation of feminism anyway?
Well, it might be, that's a fairly modern term. They certainly didn't have it in the 18th century. But maybe it's a women's movement, because we have seen people have successfully galvanized women. It's less easy to galvanize men, and men will not organize around their own victimization. That's just not going to happen. I look at what's happening to boys in school. If that were happening to girls, we would be organized. If it became 57% males, and we used to be the majority, we would organize. They're not doing a thing. And they go to these colleges where it's 50% women. I mean, 57%. They don't mind. They like it. It's the girls that are unhappy. But anyway, it's another story. So, but I'm talking about if we're going to have a women's movement, I think we need a healthy women's movement, and we could call it feminism, or, it's whatever it was called, the suffrage movement, and maybe it didn't have a name in the 18th century, but it was kind of a cultural phenomenon that I would identify as feminist. So it's not so much the feminism, but it's that women working together to solve problems. And now we don't have any kind of organized women's movement. We have a feminist movement. People think, oh, they're doing the work. First of all, they're promoting what I said. They're promoting, maybe it's for like 1970s style feminism, or we're going to give boys dolls and they'll be like girls and we'll have this unisex society. It's not going to happen. It hasn't even happened in Sweden, where they tried to do it for 40 years. It's not happened. So let's work with what's real, and let's try to improve society and do smart things. And I think that should appeal to women. And it does. And I kind of agree with Hannah Moore that women should be domestic heroines and out there, armies, improving society. But now we're all, you know, disparate, and the official women's movement is carried away with odd causes. Someone that I haven't spoken to, yes.
Hi, thank you for coming. I was wondering what your opinions about the idea and the structure of women's, historically women's colleges are, what you think their relevancy is in the feminist movement, or how they would play a role in the future.
Oh, I'm so glad you asked me that, because I just was in a debate last week with a woman named Louise Elliott, who is part of a group called Access. And it's eight professors who are against single-sex education with a vehemence. They call it gender segregation. They compare it to racial segregation. They go so far as, they even have on their website, this is so weird, on their website, teachers take a test to see how inclusive they are. Suppose you are a teacher and you say, good morning, boys and girls, or ladies and gentlemen, take out your notebook. Did you know that by their lights, that's as bad as saying, good morning, blacks and Latinos. Good morning, because you are making something that's completely irrelevant, gender, you're making it salient. Now, I think, and so they think single-sex schools, and including Wellesley, I suppose, is a kind of gender apartheid. Now, I just, as a philosopher, I rebel. It's not segregation like race. When people were segregated by race, it was, you have to look at motives and outcomes to evaluate the moral quality. Now, what were the motives of racial? They were toxic. The motive was hatred, and the idea that whites were superior was the, and the outcome horrible for the people that were victims of the segregation, and horrible for our society at large. Bad intentions, bad outcomes. Single sex education, good intentions, wonderful outcomes. Look at you. I mean, look, the whole history of single-sex education. I have reviewed the data, and I will tell you that it's a mix. You can find some scholars who will tell you, you know what, girls become more empowered. Girls. Others will say, oh no, it reinforces stereotypes, they become girly or something. Or they say, boys become more aggressive. And others say, oh no, in a single-sex school, the boys have to be in the choir, they have to do, makes them more balanced. The research is a muddle. However, a lot of research in education is a muddle. You go and look at the research, I'm sure you all think, oh, small classes, that has to be the answer. Do you know that that's just as polarized as the research about single sex? Or should you take children on field trips? Or have orchestras? Or take almost anything, gifted and talented programs. You will find literature up, and it's the same with single sex. And the reason is, and the Department of Education did a great study in 2005, and I thought it was so smart, because they finally ended by saying, you know, this is not going to be resolved by quantitative research, because it's really a question of philosophy and viewpoint. And because you can find, there are great institutions, there, you know, certainly this one would be at the top of anyone's list, and also high schools and elementary schools that are single-sex, that are great, and some that are not doing well, but if you look at the whole thing, it's a matter of philosophy and choice. So what I argue, and I've just written this paper, arguing that against the ACLU, because the ACLU is suing schools now to get them shut down. Not private schools yet, but that will be next. Because once you're able to show that it's immoral and it's discrimination, then private schools will be vulnerable. So I'm trying to fight that, because I believe in them. And I've seen enough evidence to know that students thrive. And the last thing I'll say is there's a little bit of a Hannah Moore and a Frances Willard in me, and they were great believers in women's education and women kind of that idea of an empowered femininity, and I do think these institutions encourage that and help that, so I'm in favor of it. And I would have loved to have gone here. Yes?
Hi. I had to come late, unfortunately, so I don't know if you already remarked on this, but our president of college, Tim Bonley, she recently wrote an editorial in the New York Times addressing this new system of judging school successes by how wealthy their graduates are post-graduation. And her take on this was that it doesn't matter so much how much they're paid, it's an unfair mode of judgment, because their payment is not necessarily a judgment of quality in life or contribution to society. And you've spoken a lot about pay scale, and I'm wondering your take on her opinion.
Well, that makes a lot of sense to me. If someone had come to me and said,
Christina, you're majoring in philosophy. That's a disaster. Here's a textbook on, I don't even really, fully mention here. I don't want to read that now, but I certainly didn't want to read that when I was 18. I was not interested in it. I wanted something fulfilling. However, there's fairly good data that if you look at men and women and their choice, women do want fulfillment, and they do, and there's it's a stereotype, there's truth to it. If you want to convince a woman, like even to go into a field like engineering, this is not all women, there are 20% that are different, and so don't say, oh no, that wasn't me, I know it wasn't you, but it's a lot of us. If you want to interest a woman, you have to show how it helps people. You have to show them, you know, how engineering will save lives, but that's, and they know that now, and they're trying to recruit more young women, and I think that's good. But I will say that if you look at men and women, we've got very good data about why do they choose a major. For men, they do think about income. They will say, okay, I'd really rather be a guitar player. I'd really rather, you know, would be fun to study Armenian, or I don't know, some arcane thing, but I'm going to go into and be majoring in economics. Men, far more men than women do major in economics. So I think that men don't attach as much importance to fulfillment. They put more of a premium on money and on you know, being able to support themselves. I mean, that used to be the case. I don't know what they're doing now. A lot of men are on strike or dropping out, missing in action, but hopefully we'll fix that.
I want to say one thing before you all leave. We have this amazing food that's going to be served in about 10 minutes. So think about that before you go.
Yes.
So I'm really interested by this study that the most developed countries have the most differences between the genders.
Personality, not yeah. In jobs and things. Just in terms of their, psychologists have like 8 basic personality traits and how exuberant you are and risk-taking and the poorer societies, the men and women are more alike.
So with that in mind, and also with the idea that women don't want to be men and men don't want to be women, how do you suggest tackling the disintegration of the family and the fact that there are an increasing number of families with single mothers and fathers that aren't really part of the family?
Well, I'm afraid to say I don't have the answer, but I think one helpful step would be to have more organizations. Like, there's one in Washington that I love, it's called The Third Way. And it's a new think tank, and they're trying to bring like the smartest conservative and liberal economists together to problem solve. And they just wrote a book called they just have a publication called Wayward Sons. And they're looking at the kind of free fall of young men in this society, where they are, it's actually extraordinary and something sociologists can't explain, how you have so many young men at a time where education beyond high school has never been more important, especially like working class, African American, Hispanic. You look at the young men, they are way behind their sisters in terms of their education. Working class white guys have just kind of disappeared from the education beyond high school institutions. And so in Wayward Sons, they did an analysis, and they do think that a lot of it is they conjecture that the broken family and boys raised without a father. What happens is the young women have their mom, and she's working very hard. She's a hero for them, and they get a good model. But the boy doesn't take his mother as a role model typically. I mean, sometimes they do, but often they don't. And so, and they find the mother then is getting less response from him. She gets closer with the daughters, and he drifts away, and then is more with his buddies, his friends. And they see this pattern. And they said these young men are unlikely to get married. They're increasing numbers of white working class males, Hispanic and black males, millions who are unlikely to get married, but very likely to have children. So then there is going to be more single mothers with more boys. And they say, look, this is a vicious cycle. We've got to have good policies to help. Nobody's to blame here. We have to have good policies to support these people. How do we turn it around? That's the challenge. And the thing about Third Way is they want to bring in people from conservatives and liberals together. And so, and I think they have to, because I think conservatives tend to say, oh, you know, there's been a fall of morals or in the society or something. And, you know, if boys aren't getting an education, they're not going to develop the kind of into citizens if we're not meeting them in as early as, you know, fifth or sixth grade, you've got to rescue them so they're part of the educational system. That's going to take money, that's going to take investment in education. And then liberals just say, oh, we need more policies, we need more government programs to help the single moms with the kids. But if you don't get to the root of the problem and try to, and I don't see anything around trying to fix the family. But my solution today is to say, at least let's start thinking in new ways and let's listen to each other across the political divide. And that's a big problem. And the other problem is the misogyny in the culture, like all the, I don't know, hateful things about women and so forth. It just seems to me that's something conservative and liberal women could agree with. And we'd be kind of a powerful force if we went out there. Because men will, if women come at them, they'll often, but nobody's coming at them about the misogyny. I mean, there's no organized force that's coming at them. So you can have whatever you want on the internet, and the lyrics and all that, and it's not good.
I don't want to crowd Susan, but I do want to make one comment that ties into what you were thinking. One of the things I look at is what the response of people who lose status is in societies. And what happens when you have status and lose it is you start building up what I call resentment pools. And
it's called Reddit.
But one of the interesting things I think, and this has been getting, I've thrown this out at a few people, to say, okay, it's great that we have all this inversion of power, if you will, that there are more women in medical school now than men, there are more women in law school than men, there are more women in college than men. So, you know, any sociologist would tell you that means there's going to be more wealth among women now as well. So when you have all that, and you have the demobilization of men's status, or the kind of disappearance of their position, you have the growth of these resentment pools, and resentment is almost always tied to violence in some way. So when I bring this up to people, they think that I'm actually criticizing the advancement of women, when in fact, no, I'm not. I'm just saying that over the long run, this disenfranchisement of men is likely to bark back and bite in ways that we can't even imagine now. I know it's a very pessimistic idea, but I do see a backlash coming in various parts of the world, especially with globalization empowering women through microfinance. I mean, the men are tolerating it, but I'm interested in sociologically is what factors might activate these resentment pools into violence.
Yeah.
And I'm really kind of concerned about that. I'm not sure what to do, but a lot of people don't even want to hear that because they say, oh, you're worrying about the men? We finally got success among women, and you're worried about the men? The answer is yes.
Well, you have to worry about the men because we're in this together. We're in it together. It's not like there are two separate teams. We're all together. And what you said just reminded me of another thing. The tendency in the society is to deny that there are sex differences. Here's one difference that will not go away, is that right now, for whatever reason, in our society, girls are flourishing in education and boys are not. And it starts as early as kindergarten or first grade. Some fantastic studies of how little boys are just falling behind and not catching up in every, you know, across the ability spectrum. And what you said reminded me of like a little boy. If you look at how little boys play, there's a lot of rough and tumble play, mock fighting, running around. Girls do it too, but a lot less. If you look at girls, typically there are three kinds of plays. They like to run around, but they like theatrical, imaginative games, playing house, playing school. That best friend, exchanging confidences with your friend in the playground. Boys don't do that. I've never seen it. I'm sure there are some exceptions, but they're that rough and tumble play. Now, the other thing is, little boys, 4, 5, 6 years old, they do superhero play. And they imagine, and they're probably frightened of the world, and they're imagining, they cast themselves as heroes. And I think in the male mind, there is this quest for heroism. You certainly see it in little boys, that identity with the superhero figures, and they're vanquishing bad guys and saving people. Little boys now in school, 4, 5, and 6 years old, this is not allowed. This is considered to be violence in the new world. And not only are they punished, little boys can be suspended. And two professors at the University of Maine, Mary Ellen Loeb and her colleague, did a study of preschool and first grade teachers and how often do they interfere with kids. And they found that just a huge discrepancy. Little girls are not only not interfered with, the teacher likes what they're doing. And she comes over and talks. So not only are they reinforced, they're being talked to and they're learning. And she said, play is the basis of learning. It starts in first grade kindergarten. The little boys, and this, I know if you know any little boys, this could be your little brother, and he's not happy in school. He is being, very often, and they've documented this, he could be punished and shamed or even suspended for going, bang, bang, I'm, you know, and a little boy, Alex in Colorado, threw an imaginary grenade to save the world, suspended from school. So the teacher's not coming over to him and talking to him and encouraging, write down your story. She doesn't want him to write down the story, he's suspended. This did not used to happen. This has been going on now for, well, it's an overreaction to all sorts of things in the culture. But I tell you, just as it is dangerous to overstate sex difference, it's dangerous to ignore difference. And I think ignoring the difference between boys and girls as learners, as students, is harmful to boys. And so that, and the resentment, it must build up resentment. Boys are now getting suspended a lot more than girls. I think it's something like 75% of the kids that are suspended are boys. And with these zero tolerance policies, it's often boys just for something they did because they are more likely to act out or do something, run afoul.
They're also more likely to be medicated.
Well, that's a whole other thing. 75% of the kids, the last time I read, were in some are boys that are being medicated. So these are big differences. So I think that gender scholars have led us astray somewhat by insisting we're the same, we are different, and we'd be well served to acknowledge that. But with making all sorts of special arrangements for people who don't want to be, don't want the typical gender role, I think a fair society will allow for exceptions and respect and nourish that. But I think right now the big challenge, the big new liberation movement in the United States may be for conventionally feminine women or conventionally, masculine little boys, for the traditional, those who embody the traditional gender roles, I think we have to have tolerance for them. We're getting better, we're not yet there, at being tolerant of people who defy the stereotypes or people who are gay or, transgendered. And we're getting to learn to be, I hope, more respectful and kind. But I think we have to have the same tolerance and acceptance for people who embody the traditional stereotypes. And I do think there's this friend of mine at the University of Massachusetts, a former pioneer of women's studies. She was shocked at how repressive it became. She wrote a book called Professing Feminism, Cautionary Tales from the World of Women's Studies. Her name is Daphne Patai. She wrote it with another feminist, Noretta Korte. And they have this word heterophobia, which is there's just a lot of not hatred, but intolerance for the sort of conventional romance and in some of the women's studies texts, they were able to show how there was great intolerance for traditional domesticity and so forth, what a lot of conventional women wanted, or the culture of romance. There was a lot of attack on that. And then women who wanted to be feminine and so forth. I think that's passed, but there were years in women's studies where there were very angry theories about how women were oppressed by having to be feminine. But what about all the women who think it's fun and who enjoy it, and it's who they are? So I think that's the next stage of liberation, is being more accepting of those who embody the conventional stereotypes. Yes? Yes?
Okay. And then the other side is the example you gave of the engineer example where more women just want to be in art history or whatever. Sorry, I'm kind of thinking out loud just to organize the thoughts. And we should just let that be because they're just choosing to be in art history. That's not necessarily sexism.
Yeah, I don't actually let it be. I think we should do a better job telling students, this is what you're gonna earn. If you major in art history, you will, or let's say, I don't know, it's the lowest paying field. early childhood education, you're going to earn $36,000 a year. But if you go into chemical engineering, you'll end up with $86,000 in, you know, a few years. I mean, I'm not sure that's true.
So why is it different for like women might just be like choosing to go into art history. And on the other side, why is it different for men? Like, maybe that's just the way men are moving. Like, maybe men just want to drop out of school now. I mean, I would argue that like women are less engineers because like on a Friday night, I'm not gonna sit down and study for 10 hours for my engineering exam. I need to get dressed up for a frat party that I need to like look good for in order to like get let into the frat party. And I would say that boys are now dropping out of school because of like some social circumstances of that there are more resources available for women, or there's less like reaching out to men. But I think your advocacy is something different, the opposite of that is that like women are just choosing to not go into engineering because like of their feminine nature.
Yeah, I know.
I just think like those two things are inconsistent.
I agree. And here's my explanation. I think that with boys and what's happening, it's possible that it is a problem all over the world. It's not only here. And it's possible that it's just a lot harder to get a boy interested in education, and we are working against their nature, and to get them to sit down and focus and stay there, and they mature in years.
But why should they do that, according to your advocacy?
According to my advocacy is that we should, at the very least, not work against them. We should at least meet them halfway. Now, I think that the things that we did for girls were great. I'm not here to tell you that I told you I would love for, well, I think my granddaughter Eliza, what would I like her to do? I wanted her to do what she loves. And I mean, if she wanted to be an engineer, that I would love that. But if she wants to go into art history, that's fine. But the thing is that we have had now 20 years of programs to strengthen girls in math and science. And it has been somewhat successful. But it's almost as if I just wrote about a school in Western Massachusetts. Oh, we're almost in Western Massachusetts. But it's called Black Valley Tech, I think, or Blackwater Tech, Black Valley Tech. It's a vocational school, and the girls tend to study early childhood development. It's a high school, but it's academically rigorous, and the girls study mainly cosmetology or early childhood education or some sub-medical specialties. And the boys are in the refrigeration, trucking, welding, and aviation, automobile repair. They have spent millions of dollars, not just at this school, but we have the Perkins Act coming out of Washington because of the women's groups and others. There's been huge pressure to change the girls' preferences, to get them to become the welders and the electricians. And they bring in, this one counselor told me, we bring in like really like attractive women who are electricians, and they tell them about their career and all that, and they give the girls special scholarships, and their money from Washington is threatened if they don't get the more girls in these fields. So I said, do you do this a lot? She said, it's all we do. They even have a word for it, non-trads, the non-traditionals. You've got to get your non-trad points up or your state will take away your money. So they're trying to get these girls. So I look at that and I say, I mean, I think it's great. I'm still enough of a feminist, first woman, bullfighter. Well, I don't like bullfighting. That's too cruel. But race car driver, I like that. But on the other hand, how far do you go to try to change preferences? I think you should make an effort, and that you should. I think it's good that these schools have mentors and bring in. But second thing, you should put just as much effort into helping boys do what they want to do. And I'm not sure that it's so important that we have to change and kind of re-engineer the preferences of boys and girls. I think if we just opened up opportunities and let the girl who wanted to be a welder make sure we don't prevent that. That's what I'm calling for. That's what I call freedom feminism is. do everything you can for equality of opportunity. But don't expect sameness because we're just not the same.
And then where do you fall for family structure? Like, why can't family structure be freedom family structure? I want to be a single mom. I want to be, you know, whatever.
Well, here's another thing. If it worked, if I thought it worked, I wouldn't complain. But I think that we're facing a social, I don't want to say catastrophe, but this can't go on. And if you've looked at the latest data of the number of children that are born out of wedlock, and that usually means growing up without fathers. And fatherlessness, there are children in many who make admirable adjustments, but for many kids, and especially boys, it exacts a terrible toll on their education and on their entire futures. This is just what we see, that the safest and healthiest place for a child to be is with two parents in a home. And we should at least work hard to make that something people aspire to. However, to conservatives, I say that there's a reason these boys can't marry these women and give homes, because they have no jobs. Mm-hmm. They can't, because what has happened to the working class in America is that they're just, the bottom has fallen out. And so, but we should have been there, as they have been more in Germany and Australia. They're right there training their people. Their high schools are sometimes career technical. They train them so they can survive. We're not doing that. And we're in the fallout, there have been horrible economic and social consequences. And if I thought that it worked, just any family, just a mom with people, you do see on television, they kind of celebrate that as, you know, liberating or something. For most people, it's not liberating. It's very hard to raise even one child by yourself. And so for a single mom, it's very hard. And my heart goes out to all of them, but so I want to help them, but how do we stop a culture of fatherlessness? And I think that's a big social challenge of the age.
I always feel very masculine and paternalistic when I shut off such a great conversation, but in recompense for that, I offer wonderful food. I'd like to thank our speaker who gave a wonderful presentation.